he leads and what wisdom.
Good morning, Cornerstone family. He is risen. He's risen. Oh man, it's been such a roller coaster ride of emotions for me. Last Friday was Good Friday. I was feeling a little heavy. And then on Sunday, we had baptism as a celebration. And I just wonder, who here was baptized here at Cornerstone ever? Can I have a show of hands? Oh, give them a hand. Nice. And I'm so excited. It feels like a new beginning this week. I have my Lent commitment, and I can finally have bubble tea. And we are starting a brand new series called Relational Spaces, because we all grow in Christ differently. And for those of you who are brand new to this church or has never heard of the gospel, I'm sure you've heard of his name before. He's a name above all names. There's no God like him, and there ever will be, because he was willing to die for our sins, and his resurrection means that we can live. This is amazing grace, Jesus. Will you rise and celebrate with us?
Slain.
Done for me. All that you've done for me. Would you join me in reading this passage from the Message translation together? Psalm 96, verse 1 to 4. Sing God a brand new song, earth and everyone in it. Sing, sing to God, worship God, shout the news of his victory from sea to sea. Take the news of his glory to the lost, news of his wonders to one and all, for God is great and worth a thousand hallelujahs. Let's do that. Would rocks cry out to worship? Whose glory taught the stars to shine? Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing, but this joy is mine.
Bye.
magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more. Church, let us pray. Oh, Father God, we come here this morning to praise you and thank you and give you the glory. We are here this morning to gather in the name of your Son, who died and rose again to give us life. And for that, a thousand hallelujahs would not be enough to sing your praise. Father, as we have reflected this last week over Easter, already seems like so long ago. Lord, help us remember that we live in light of the cross every day. We live in the shadow of the cross, but that is not a dark shadow. That is a shadow of light, of joy, of peace, and reconciliation. Father, we thank you that you came to us through Jesus, that you sought a way that all men and women might come to you and be your children. We thank you that Jesus gave his life, and to prove that he was the one who he said he was, he rose from the dead. And we gather this morning to declare that name and to give you the praise and the glory you deserve, because you truly are the ruler of heaven and earth. Father, we think of our world this week. We think particularly of Taiwan and the earthquakes. We pray for support and comfort for those who have been affected. For the families of those who have lost loved ones, we pray for your comfort. For those who have damaged property, Lord, we pray for your compassion and your provision. We continue to pray for those hot spots in the world right now suffering from war and famine. We think of those in our own community here in Markham, in this church, who are grieving, who are struggling. Father, would you wrap your loving arms around them and bring people close so that they may feel your comfort. Oh Lord, we thank you for this church here at Cornerstone. We thank you for these people that you've put around us that we get to call friends. No, we get to call family because of what you've done. We pray for this church. We pray for our leaders as we continue to expand our staff team this year. Would you pray, would you lead our staff leadership team to help make those right decisions? Father, we thank you for gathering us here this morning. We thank you that we have the freedom to come and say hallelujah. Praise Yahweh. May that be on our lips every week, every day, even every hour, because of what you have done through Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, welcome again to Cornerstone this morning, everyone. Why don't you take a minute, say hi to someone behind you or in front of you. If you're online, say hi in the chat. Welcome someone here to Cornerstone this morning. It is so good to have you all with us. Now, if this is your first time here at Cornerstone, an extra special welcome to you. We would love to have a quick chat with you out in the foyer. You'll see a sign that says welcome. We have a special gift for you. So if this is your first time here, we would love to be able to acknowledge that. Just go over and say hi to the nice folks at the welcome desk after the service this morning on your way out of the auditorium. And it might not be your first time here, but I know that there's always people that have just recently started coming to Cornerstone. Maybe it's your second or third or tenth time with us, and you'd like to know a little bit more about this community and what makes us special. Well, we have a program designed exactly for that. It's called Discover Cornerstone.
It's coming up on May the 5th. It's going to be after this second service. We provide a great lunch. Always worth coming just for the food here at Cornerstone, I tell you. Okay, so if you're new to Cornerstone, if you haven't been to a Discover Cornerstone session before, you do need to register for it. So there's a QR code, or if you're online, it's down there somewhere. Make sure you sign up for that so you can get that spot covered and that lunch provided for you. We would love to have you come and learn. You meet some of our team and you learn more about our history and what makes us tick. Now, we have, even though we're still just realizing it's spring, that the weather's still vacillating between hot and cold, we know that summer is coming. And in summer here at Cornerstone, we have a history of running camps for kids. So we have a sports camps for grades 4 to 7 that's running July 8th to the 12th. So if you have kids in grades 4 to 7, you have neighbors with kids in grades 4 to 7, you have family or just a kid on the street that looks like they're in grades 4 to 7, you want to invite them along to register for this camp. Now, I will tell you that I think we're going to sell out of the program. We only have a limited number of spots, so I do encourage you to get that word out there. Register your kids, your friends and family. Make sure they get registered for this program because I don't think it'll last. Now, I was looking at the program with all the things they're going to do at the sports camp. I am tired just reading the program. They are going to be doing volleyball, basketball, soccer, ultimate frisbee, badminton, table tennis. They're going to have a lot of fun doing a lot of different activities. So you definitely want to get these grades 4 to 7 kids registered for that program. My next announcement is also about food. Open Table Thursday. For those that have been before, no introductions necessary. For those that haven't been before, this is a place we come on a Thursday evening. We hang out. We don't have to cook. We don't have to clean up. We get to chat with friends, have a good meal, and it's just a great community space for our church. So that is happening this Thursday on the 11th. If you would like to attend, again, you do need to register for that. So please make sure you fill in the online form. And then finally, we just sent a missions team to Nicaragua in March. After this service, they are having a debrief. They're going to walk us through what they did while they were there. They're going to introduce us to our mission partners, Verbo Church, and they are going to introduce us to some of the kids that we have sponsored through Compassion and the work they have done with those kids while they were in Nicaragua. So if you're at all interested in that, it's going to be a fantastic, informative event. Just make your way out after the service. Usually it's in room 100, I think, we'll be hosting a time of storytelling, of sharing and exploring the work that we've done with Verbo Church and with Compassion Nicaragua. Why don't we put our hands together, welcome Pastor Steve to kick us off on our new series.
Thanks, Peter. Good morning, everyone. Just before I begin today's message, I want to let you know that our new young adults pastor, Gordon Poon, is here with us for his first official Sunday as our member of our ministry staff team. Stand up and give us a wave over there, Gord. All right. We welcome you. Gord's wife is Becca, and they have an adorable 4-year-old daughter named Amelia as well. When you get a chance, introduce yourself, get to know them. Not all at once, though. We don't want to overwhelm them. Okay, having spent the last 3 months making our way through the New Testament letter of Philippians verse by verse, today we're going to turn a corner and begin a new series on the topic of discipleship. Specifically, over the next 4 weeks, we are going to explore how Jesus works in different relational spaces to shape us as his disciples. The series aligns very well with Cornerstone's mission statement, making space for Jesus to shape people together in God's love. When you break it down, the essence of that statement is that Cornerstone exists to make disciples of Jesus Christ. To be a disciple is to follow Jesus as your master. It is to be his apprentice, to model your life, your thoughts, your words, your actions after his example by the empowering presence of his Spirit. In shaping us to become like him, Jesus shapes us in God's love, because God's love is fully and perfectly revealed in Jesus Christ. especially in his cross. Indeed, being shaped in self-sacrificial, Christ-like love for the sake of others is at the very heart of God's purposes for you and me. One of the things I like about Cornerstone's mission statement is that it clarifies what our job is when it comes to making disciples and what Jesus' job is. Our job is to make space for Jesus. Jesus' job, by his Spirit, is to shape people together in God's love. Only he can do that by the power of his Spirit. And because love is relational through and through, love is a relational word, right? Our main job as a church is to create relational spaces where people can be shaped together in God's love as they encounter Jesus and each other. This series, as I said a moment ago, is about how Jesus works across different relational spaces or contexts to shape us as his disciples. In particular, we're going to be considering four relational spaces across the course of this series that we see Jesus using in his own disciple-making ministry as recorded in the biblical gospels. And he continues to use these spaces to disciple people today. In doing so, Jesus was clearly onto something because there's a modern-day cultural anthropologist named Edward T. Hall who discovered through his research that the same four relational spaces, regardless of culture, are fundamental to how human beings communicate, connect, and interact with each other. For the purposes of this series, we're going to adapt Hall's language a bit and refer to these four relational spaces as follows. First of all, there are public spaces. And these are gatherings of 100 or more people around a shared event or experience. The focus is primarily on that shared event or experience rather than building relational depth with the others who are there. Then there are social spaces. These are gatherings of 20 to 70 or so people where we can kind of share snapshots of who we are and build affinity with others. Then there are personal spaces. These are groups of 4 to about 12 people where we can reveal ourselves on a more personal level. And then finally, there are transparent spaces, microgroups of 2 to 3, maybe 4 people where true vulnerability, openness, and candor can be shared. Obviously, Jesus himself didn't use the language of public, social, personal, and transparent spaces, but he clearly leveraged these spaces in his ministry to make disciples, and he did so 2 millennia before any modern anthropologist or sociologist would identify or name them. This next chart you can see on the screen shows us that in terms of public spaces, Jesus would often teach and minister to large crowds numbering in the hundreds or even thousands. In terms of social-sized spaces, we know that Jesus had a circle of disciples called the 70 that he would send out on kingdom mission. As well, Jesus could often be found connecting with and reaching people in social contexts like dinner parties, like he did with Matthew, the tax collector, and Zacchaeus. In terms of personal space, if you're a Christian, you know, you should know well by now that Jesus invested a disproportionate amount of his time with his small group of 12, the 12 disciples. And in terms of transparent space, there were 3 disciples among the 12 that Jesus was particularly close with and to whom he was especially transparent. Those 3 are Peter, James, and John. Now, if Jesus continues to use the same kinds of relational spaces to make disciples today, then our job as a church is either to make such spaces available or to point people to where they are available. In Cornerstone's context, here's what that tends to look like. In terms of public spaces, well, we're in one right now. The primary public space we offer is our Sunday worship service. And we also sometimes have large-scale community events. Social spaces consist of things like fellowship groups. We have young adults gatherings. We have Freedom 55, which is a seniors gathering in the social space. We have open table Thursday dinners, semester groups, recreation programs. Serving on a ministry team can be a form of being in a social space where you share snapshots of who you are and build affinities with your teammates. And then we have our newcomers class, which Peter mentioned, called Discover Cornerstone, which is that same social kind of space. In terms of personal spaces, we have small groups. And in terms of transparent spaces, well, these are things like your marriage, if you're married, close Christian friendships, discipleship and accountability groups of 2 to 4 people, things like Christian counseling and spiritual direction that are one-on-one. While some of our ministries occupy a single space, small groups, for example, land solidly in the personal space, we also have some ministries where as many as 2 to 3 of these relational spaces overlap. Our youth ministry, for example, regularly incorporates social and personal size spaces, and sometimes public size spaces because they can get to be over 100. What's important to understand, though, is that these four spaces form a framework in which Jesus shapes us through our relationships with other people, usually with other followers of Jesus. And therefore, each space is important. Each space has a place because each space is set up to deliver a certain set of discipleship outcomes that the other spaces aren't well set up to deliver. Well, what does that mean for all of us? Well, for one thing, it means that as a church, we can't put all our eggs in the Sunday worship service basket, for example, or we can't put all our eggs in the small group basket. We need to invest and point people toward all four relational spaces, which we've endeavored to do as a church over the years, although currently some spaces need a little more development than others. Another thing that this means is that in your own personal journey of following Jesus, you shouldn't put all your eggs into any one relational space basket. While a certain space may be a special focal point in your life for a season, each of the four relational spaces needs to play an important part in your overall discipleship journey over time. So there's an overview of what this series is going to be about. And wherever you may be in your own journey with Jesus, our prayer is that you will hear the Lord's voice through this series and follow His lead when it comes to connecting across these four spaces. Be listening for God's invitation for any next steps He would have you take in any given space. In the time that remains, we're going to do a deeper dive into the first of the four relational spaces, that is public space. Remember what we said before. In the public context, we gather around a shared event or experience in groups of 100 or more. And for our purposes today, the shared event or experience we're going to focus on is what we're doing right now, the Sunday worship service. When it comes to public spaces, we saw earlier that Jesus would frequently teach and minister to large crowds, like when he gave his famous Sermon on the Mount, or when he fed the 5,000. A great example of Jesus using the public space is found in Mark's gospel. So Jesus and his disciples are coming in from a boat trip, and when Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. Interestingly, though, most early Christians didn't have access to venues large enough to host public scale events, so they would meet for worship in smaller sized, social sized gatherings in homes, anywhere from 20 to 70 people or so. That said, the book of Acts tells us that the very first Christians, who were from a Jewish background, would meet not only in homes, but they also assembled in the temple courts in Jerusalem for what would have likely been larger scale worship gatherings. So we read in Acts 2 that those who accepted Peter's message that day were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Every day they continued to meet in the temple courts. They broke bread also in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. It's important to realize that as a public space, Sunday services are set up to deliver certain aspects of discipleship much more effectively than the other three spaces are. That said, we must not expect a Sunday worship service to magically deliver aspects of relational discipleship that it isn't set up to. The key question we need to ask is this: what discipleship outcomes is a Sunday worship service like this especially well set up to deliver? Today we're going to consider two of those outcomes, the first of which is recalibration and renewal in Jesus. In public worship services, we join with as many as hundreds of others in worshiping our crucified and risen Lord Jesus. As we raise our voices together in unison, our minds and hearts turn toward Him as we gaze on His awesome majesty, beauty, and love. And whatever kind of week you may be coming off of, public worship gives you a special opportunity to lift your focus away from self and put it onto Jesus. Through liturgy, music, the declaration of God's word, and the Lord's Supper, you can be refreshed and replenished in Him. At the same time, this experience is not yours alone because you're in the presence of other worshipers. By coming to Sunday worship, you can be strengthened as you're reminded that you have the benefit of belonging to a family that is much bigger and greater than you are and than your problems are. The church is the family of God, and you're a part of it. Asaph was the writer of Psalm 73 and other psalms. He was going through a crisis of faith, seeing that the wicked only seemed to prosper and the righteous only seemed to suffer. He was ready to give up on God altogether. And this guy was a spiritual leader of his people. He was ready to drop kick his faith. At one point, he writes, "When I tried to understand all this, it troubled me deeply. Till I entered the sanctuary of God." Asaph is at a loss to figure things out. His faith is at an all-time low. But things begin to turn around for him when? When he enters the sanctuary of God. In other words, when he went to the place of public worship, in his case, it would have been the temple in Jerusalem. He went deeply troubled. But you know what? He still showed up. He showed up, if for no other reason, just by force of habit, he showed up. Follower of Jesus, whether you feel like it or not, make it your habit to show up for Sunday worship every single week. If for some reason you can't be here in person, maybe because of your health, you can show up online. It's very likely that here, with God's family surrounding you, you'll find fresh perspective leading to recalibration and renewal in Jesus. Because Asaph entered the sanctuary that day, he experienced a turnaround that inspired him to write one of the most beautiful prayers you'll find in Scripture. He wrote to God, "Whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire beside you. My heart and my flesh may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." Like Asaph, when we make a point of showing up for Sunday worship, we give ourselves a vital opportunity each week to become retuned to the presence of God and strengthened to follow His will and His way as we go about our lives, even in difficult circumstances. Another way Sunday worship services help recalibrate and renew us in Jesus is by providing movement and momentum in our discipleship journey. And keep in mind, when you come to Sunday worship, you're not just coming for what you can get out of it, but also for what you can give to somebody else. Because even though Sunday worship isn't a place where relationships usually go deep, there's lots of opportunity for relational connection in a place like this. And so a word of welcome, encouragement, a word of care, a little short time of prayer as you pull somebody off to the side, some act of service might help move someone forward in their journey with Jesus as well. So it's not just about what you get. It's also about what you can give. Time and again, I've heard stories about how people who were not yet baptized came to a Sunday worship service where we had a baptism service. And they were inspired by the testimonies of the baptismal candidates to the point that they decided to get baptized themselves. Like coming to worship on a baptism Sunday, they experienced movement and momentum in their own journey as disciples of Jesus. And don't underestimate the impact of announcements during a Sunday worship service. Shout out to everyone who does announcements for us. So we saw Peter today, Cherry, Linda, Bethany, and others. Yeah, announcement people. Announcement people. During announcements, we share what's going on in the wider life of the church across these four spaces and invite people to engage in these opportunities as the Lord leads. So joining a Bible class or a small group, serving in a ministry, coming to Open Table Thursday, for example, joining a global mission team. As you connect in these ways, you experience movement and momentum in your discipleship to Jesus, quite possibly because you heard about it during Sunday announcements, and God said, that's for you. Furthermore, people who are not yet followers of Jesus join us for worship services on any given Sunday. I'm sure there are some here today, right now. Some come because they were invited by a Christian friend or relative. Maybe they come reluctantly. Some come because an inner compulsion drew them here. Some come because they are feeling desperate for God's help. Some come because of a connection they've made through one of our community events, or maybe they were served through one of our outreach ministries. Our Sunday services, you see, always offer our neighbors a predictable time and space to connect with the church when they feel ready to do so. And over the years, hundreds of our neighbors have done just that. Even if they only pop in on occasion, like Christmas and Easter, or maybe in times of felt loss or need, nonetheless, you know, a lot of our neighbors out there who you won't find here every Sunday, they feel like Cornerstone is their church, even if they only show up a couple times a year. That may be surprising to us, but to them it's very true reality. In 1 Corinthians, Paul talks about how unbelievers can come into a worship gathering, hear God's truth proclaimed, and find that God is speaking straight into their hearts, straight into their life situation, to the point that they fall down in worship and say, God is really among you. I can name specific people who came to a service like this as an unbeliever and encountered Jesus in life-changing ways. I'm thinking of a woman who, in her first visits to Cornerstone worship services, found that the worship songs moved her so much that she just couldn't stop crying. Something about the lyrics and the movement of the music touched her soul deeply, and she experienced God's nearness and love. And the thing is, she explained, I'm not even a crier, like not even close. But the tears just wouldn't stop flowing when those songs were being sung. In time, this woman was baptized and is a committed follower of Jesus to this day. I'm also thinking of a couple who joined Cornerstone for worship services years ago, and during a time of communion came to realize that Jesus' body was broken for me, and his blood was shed for me. And through that element of the worship service, Jesus was drawing them into relationship with him. This couple was baptized and is still serving the Lord at Cornerstone to this day. I'm also thinking of a guy who started attending Cornerstone worship services years ago, and he noticed how I would raise my hands in worship. And later, he would come to admit that initially he thought I looked absolutely ridiculous. This lanky white guy waving his arm all around like some fool, I think is how he put it. So it's kind of like one of those, you know, one of those flappy things that you see at the used car dealership? Yeah, that was me. But then he explained that as he continued to join us for worship and he watched me doing that, he became inspired by the fact that I didn't care how I looked or what other people thought of me. I just wanted to show my affection to Jesus. And at some point along the way, he told me, I started to really respect that. It's one of the many pieces of the puzzle that God joined together for him to lead him to Jesus. Not only do Sunday worship services help us in our disciple-making mission as a church by providing a space that is especially helpful for people to experience recalibration and renewal in Jesus, there's a second discipleship outcome that Sunday worship services are especially well set up to deliver, and that is biblical teaching. Biblical teaching. The Apostle Paul once exhorted Timothy, his protege, a young pastor, with these words. I solemnly urge you in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead when he comes to set up his kingdom, preach the word of God. Be prepared, whether the time is favorable or not, patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage your people with good teaching. Paul's exhortation to young pastor Timothy applies to those of us entrusted with the ministry of preaching and teaching here at Cornerstone. We are, by God's grace and with the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, to patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage you all with good teaching from the Word of God, the Scriptures. And the primary space where that happens in this and most churches is our Sunday worship services. Happens in lots of other places too. But Sunday worship service is primary for biblical teaching. Of course, the best biblical teaching is so much more than the transfer of information. The best biblical teaching gives us a vision of the good life. As pastor and author John Mark Comer says, good biblical teaching undermines the untrue stories we believe. It says, this is true and this is a lie. It rewires our mental maps to reality, making it possible for us to live in alignment with reality in such a way that we flourish and thrive according to God's good wisdom and intentions. Comer goes on to say, nowhere is this truer than in the teaching we receive about God. As A.W. Tozer famously said, what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us, because we become like our mental picture of God. And for this reason, discipleship to Jesus begins with the healing of the false images we have of God. And therefore, above all, good biblical teaching should always point us to the one to whom Scripture points. If you want to know what good biblical teaching is, remember this. Good biblical teaching should always point us to the one to whom all the Scriptures points. The one who is the ultimate revelation of God himself, Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Good biblical teaching always points to Jesus. To counter the daily barrage of straight-up lies we receive from the world around us, as disciples of Jesus, we must prioritize exposure to good biblical teaching and truth. There are all sorts of ways to do this. But to do it during Sunday worship service with the wider congregation all together is perhaps the primary space where this happens as we learn and grow under the same teaching as a community of faith. Biblical teaching can be especially impactful in a public context like a Sunday worship service. Why is that? Well, it's because a preacher's comments are not aimed at specific individuals, but rather at a large group. And because of this, hearers tend to be less defensive and are usually better able to acknowledge and perceive how God is speaking into their life in a moment like this. I cannot tell you the number of times when one of us will have been up here preaching on a Sunday, and after service, someone will come up to us and comment, Pastor, it felt like that message was just for me. God was speaking straight to my heart. I felt like I was the only one in the room. In fact, I heard someone make a comment about that as recently as our 9:30 service. And before that, last Sunday, Easter Sunday. Furthermore, difficult topics can be tackled on a Sunday sermon or in a series with a candidness and directness that can be sometimes harder to achieve in other contexts. Along these lines, please pray for our preaching team as we prepare for a sermon series this fall on biblical sexuality. In the words of Paul to Timothy, pray that we would preach the word of God, that we would be prepared whether the time is favorable or not, and to patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage you all with good teaching, good biblical, Jesus-centered teaching, full of grace and truth. Amen? Will you pray for us? Please pray. Biblical teaching in the public space of a Sunday worship service also allows core content or vision to be shared with a large number of people at the same time, calling the whole congregation to action in an area of God's calling or leading or in an area of need. This has been incredibly strategic for Cornerstone's overall journey as a church on mission for God over the years. And it's one of the reasons why it's so important to be consistent in your Sunday worship services. If you're not here, you miss out on what God is doing in the greater life of community. And just kind of like coals in a campfire, you know, you're sitting around a campfire. If a coal is in the campfire, it's orange, it's hot at that certain point, or it gets white hot. But pick up that coal with tongs and put it on the dirt a few feet away. What happens? Cools off very quickly. Put it back. It warms up very quickly. And for this reason, Hebrews tells us, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Finally, good biblical teaching should always leave you with something to do. Ways to apply the truth you've been hearing. As the Bible says in James, but don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you're only fooling yourselves. For this reason, we often give you something to do in connection with our sermons, a practice, a prayer exercise, a resource to use, an opportunity to sign up for, an action step to take. And along these lines, guess what? I have two takeaways for you as I wrap up this message. The first takeaway is simply this. Make a commitment to God, not to me, to God, to make attendance at Sunday worship service just a weekly priority for you. Attend Sunday worship service weekly. Statistics say that these days, those who describe themselves as committed Christians attend Sunday worship on average, how many times per month would you guess? Yeah, somebody got it. It's two. I think we talked about this a couple months ago. Two per month. That's what committed Christians say they tend to attend in terms of frequency. But I hope you've been convinced today that Sunday worship services are too important a piece of your discipleship journey to be that lax in your attendance. And if you are a parent, don't forget that your attendance or your non-attendance sends a very powerful message to your kids, impacting their faith formation for better or for worse. The second application is to pray to prepare yourself for a Sunday worship service like this. And to help you with that, we've put together a special handout for you. It's called Prayers to Prepare for Sunday Worship. It has seven rich prayers that you can pick and choose from. Pray a couple of those prayers on a Saturday night or a Sunday morning before you come to worship service. One of the prayers is called A Prayer for Those Ministering on Sunday, and it helps you cover the teams and individuals that usually serve during our Sunday worship services. I tell you, they would very much appreciate, and they need, your prayer cover. So you can grab a free copy of that handout at the welcome desk on the way out, and you can also download a copy at the link you see on the screen. Well, today we've talked about the first of the four relational spaces that Jesus uses to shape us as his disciples, public space, and the Sunday worship service in particular. We've seen that Sunday worship services are especially effective at delivering two vitally important discipleship outcomes. One, recalibration and renewal in Jesus, and two, biblical teaching. Next Sunday, Pastor Andrew will do some more biblical teaching about the place of social-sized spaces of 20 to 70 people in our disciple-making mission. But now, Let's turn to the Lord and his table. Would you bow with me for a short word of prayer? Lord Jesus, as we gather around your table this morning, we thank you for the unity and fellowship we share as members of your body, your people. Bless this time of communion, we pray, that it may recalibrate and renew us in you and strengthen our relationships with one another. In your name we pray. Amen. In 1 Corinthians 10, the Apostle Paul says, "The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread." The bread is Christ's body broken for us, reminding us of the sacrifice he made for our salvation. The cup is his blood shed for us, speaking of the new covenant of forgiveness of sin and reconciliation with God and each other through Christ. So in communion, we are not only nourished spiritually, but we're also united with Christ afresh and also with one another as members of his body. I'd like to invite you to pray with me once more. Merciful God, we confess that we have fallen short of your glory and have not always lived in harmony with you and with each other. Forgive us, cleanse us, renew us, we pray, that we may walk in love and reconciliation as members of your body, the church. In Jesus' name, amen. And now, hear the good news. In Christ, we are forgiven. Through his sacrifice, we are reconciled to God and to one another. And as we come to this table of communion, may the unity and fellowship we have experienced today continue to strengthen our relationships throughout this body of Christ in the weeks to come. From here, may God send us forth in his peace and love to serve him, each other, and the wider world in the power of his Spirit. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you." And in the same way, after the supper, he took the cup and said, "This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. And every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, remember me until I come again." The instructions for how we're going to do the Lord's Supper can be found on the screen. Ushers will come and dismiss you to line up at the communion stations row by row. Please follow their guidance as they dismiss your row. If you have limited mobility, we would be happy to serve you right where you're seated. Simply raise your hand once we begin the communion service, and a mobile server will come and serve you right where you are. All who want to draw near to Jesus today are welcome to his table, because he would turn away no one who would come to his table who really wants to draw near to him. These are the gifts of God for the people of God and for those who are becoming people of God. Receive them with thanksgiving in your heart and be nourished in your faith as we now feast on Jesus. God bless you as you celebrate the Lord's Supper, church.
can we learn to appreciate the privilege of this time and this space where we come together to meet God, to hear His truth, and to be moved forward closer to Him in our relationship. He is so good. Hebrews 10 says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. By His death, Jesus opened a new and life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. And since we have a great high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting Him. Let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep His promise. And let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works." Can we pray together as we prepare our hearts to give our tithes and our offerings back to God? Lord Jesus, what can we say to such a gift, to such a privilege, except thank you? Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. You have torn the curtain. You have removed the barrier. You have opened the way for us to not only come boldly into your presence, but for your very spirit to live in our hearts. And so, Lord, we pray together as a community that you would shape us into people who love the way that you love, who serve the way that you served, who give the way that you gave. Lord, would you change us this morning by your generous love so that we can express your generous love to the people around us. We pray these things in your precious name, Jesus. Amen. Ushers, please come forward to accept our gifts to God. And so, death is defeated. The enemy is under God's feet, and we are free, all because of Jesus. Can we stand together and declare that truth?
Yeah.
thank you for joining us for worship today, whether you're with us in person or online. Let's say hello to our online family, everyone on the count of three. Hello, online family. One, two, three. Hello, online family. All right. That's great. Well, I found a benediction that I thought fits so well with this series, so let me share it with you, and I invite you to lift your hands into a receptive posture. May the love of God that binds us together as one family in Christ lead us to cherish the beauty of relationships. May our relationship with Jesus and with each other be a beacon of light to a watching world. And may the wisdom, empathy, and compassion of the Holy Spirit guide our interactions, nourishing unity and peace. Go now, recalibrated, renewed, and strengthened by the power of the love of Christ. Amen. Amen. Make sure to pick up a handout, Prayers to Prepare for Sunday Worship, on your way out, and then use that to prepare for worship in the weeks to come. God bless you, church. Have a great week.